All right. It is September 24th. It is a Thursday, and we're looking at Genesis 49, verse 29 to 50:14. All right, that's 49:29 to 50:14. And we are getting closer and closer to the end of Genesis. And so I'm just going to read it through today's passage, and talk more about who God. I know that's like the emphasis and point of every Bible passage, but something about God being revealed in these last moments of Jacob. And so Genesis 49:29 is our starting point, and we will go all the way to verse 14 of 50. All right. And so verse 29, then he gave them these instructions: I am about to be gathered to my people. Bury me with my fathers in the cave in the field of Ephron the Hittite, the cave in the field of Machpelah near Mamre in Canaan, with which Abraham bought along with the field as a burial place from Ephron the Hittite. There Abraham and his wife Sarah were buried. There Isaac and his wife Rebekah were buried. And there I buried Leah. The field and the cave in it were bought from the Hittites. When Jacob had finished giving instructions to his sons, he drew his feet up into the bed, breathed his last, and was gathered to his people. Joseph threw himself on his father and wept over him and kissed him. Then Joseph directed the physicians in his service to embalm his father Israel. So the physicians embalmed him, taking a full 40 days, for that was the time required for embalming. And the Egyptians mourned for him 70 days. When the days of mourning had passed, Joseph said to Pharaoh's court, "If I found favor in your eyes, speak to Pharaoh for me. Tell him, my father made me swear an oath and said, 'I'm about to die. Bury me in the tomb I dug for myself in the land of Canaan. Now let me go up and bury my father, then I will return.' Pharaoh said, 'Go up and bury your father, as he made you swear to do.' So Joseph went up to bury his father. All Pharaoh's officials accompanied him, the dignitaries of his court and all the dignitaries of Egypt, besides all the members of Joseph's household and his brothers and those belonging to his father's household. Only their children and their flocks and herds were left in Goshen. Chariots and horsemen also went up with him. It was a very large company. When they had reached the threshing floor of Atad near the Jordan, they lamented loudly and bitterly. And there Joseph observed a 7-day period of mourning for his father. When the Canaanites who lived there saw the mourning of the threshing floor of Atad, they said, 'The Egyptians are holding a solemn ceremony of mourning. That is why they place that place near the Jordan is called Abel Mizraim.' So Jacob's sons did as he had commanded them. They carried him to the land of Canaan and buried him in the cave in the field of Machpelah near Mamre, which Abraham had bought along with the field as a burial place from Ephron the Hittite. After burying his father, Joseph returned to Egypt together with his brothers and all the others who had gone with him to bury his father." Let's pray. God, today, may your word shine upon us a path on which we are to walk, revealing who you are and what we are called to do. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right. We're at the tail end, and I feel like I've been saying that for a really long time. We seem to be dragging out this story as much as possible. But today, we're seeing the end of Jacob's life, right? And Jacob, this whole story of Jacob is coming to a conclusion. It's been going on for quite some time. And we're seeing a major transition happen. The age of the patriarchs, meaning the Abraham, Joseph, Jacob, Isaac, all those that era is closing. And we're about to actually head into a new book, the Exodus. But more so than moving a page over, we're starting to see a change in the era, right? The house, the God's people that has been chosen, the house of Abraham, is going to go from just a family to a nation, to just a tribe, to tribes. And we see, meaning the many tribes of Israel or God's people. And so we're going through this changing, a big transition is happening right now. And with Jacob dying, Israel, it's kind of like stamping the old kind of era as they move into a new era. And what is very interesting is that even though the patriarchs are dying, or pretty much the patriarch, that season, that era is passing and a new era is coming, though the people change, God is still the same. And one of the major themes that has been introduced in Genesis is this idea of covenant. And what is covenant? Now, covenant is this idea where some people can equate the word as a contract, as a relationship built on contract. And that's what happened with Abraham, right? God made this contract with Abraham saying, I will do this, this, and this in your life if you do this, this, and this. And so he builds this covenant, this relationship with expectations on both ends. An example of a covenant is marriage between husband and wife. There is a marriage covenant, meaning there's like an agreement that you, this person and this person are together and no other person should be in this relationship and that they're committed to one another. That's the same thing that God has done with Abraham and his descendants. And I'm realizing that as we are in the season of transition in the passage, that God is continuing the story of this development of a covenant he made long ago with one person. Because he made this covenant with Abraham, but as he made this covenant with Abraham, he's saying, this covenant is going to live beyond you, and I'm going to carry it through the generations to come. And so some people, some like scholars and smart people, they talk about how God is a covenant God, meaning his covenant with his people is the major essence of who he is. And that God's covenant will stretch to generation, to generation, to generation, to the end of time, to eternity. That he has a covenant with God's people. And so what is very interesting that we look at today is the covenant of God moves beyond every generation. That each generation has a part to play in the covenant, in the development and the exposure and the spread of it, right? But the God is the one that remains the same throughout each generation, because he's going to slowly but surely fulfill every aspect of a promise he gave centuries, a millennium ago. And when we look at today's passage, we see that the patriarchs are passing and a new generation is coming. And like a relay race, every generation prior is handing over the baton to the next generation. And that this is something that's going to happen from time and time and time again. And then when we look at the church now, that the church now has to come to the realization that they are not the be-all, end-all, but they too are going to eventually pass on a legacy to the next generation that's going to be the church until Jesus Christ comes back, right? And so going back from yesterday's devotion, the idea that how we live now actually affects what the future is going to look like. When we say that, we're not just simply saying the future for us as individuals, but the future of those that come after us, right? That how we live now affects and sets up the generation that comes after us. And so with that in mind, we have to ask ourselves, what kind of legacy are we living, right? And you might say, oh, this is not something I have to think about until like I'm an older person. And you know, that term older person is so vague. It's like, what does that mean? But every person or generation or age group has an ability to leave a legacy. Leave a fingerprint. I know some schools with the high school students, what they do is that they leave put a paint on their hand and they leave it on, like put their handprints on a wall to leave kind of like their mark on the school. That every school and generation has a mark that they leave behind. And so the question that you and I will have to ask ourselves is, what kind of mark are we going to leave? Because our time will pass, but God will continue to move forward with the next generation. And what we can do is to participate in that by deciding to leave a legacy of blessing rather than a legacy of curse. And so that's something that I want to ask you guys today is this. God is a God that is covenant God that builds with every generation. But with each generation, he's asking, What kind of handprint are you going to leave behind? What kind of fingerprint are you going to leave behind? And that is the question. Today's devotion is very short, but one deep question that we have to ask ourselves is, what kind of mark are we going to leave? Are we going to leave a mark of blessing and cutting off every curse that came before us? Or are we going to pass on curses and bad habits or bad mindsets or bad lifestyles? Because what we do leaves marks. What kind of mark are we going to leave today? Simple, short, to the point, but profoundly powerful if we take it seriously. Let me pray. God, we just thank you for this time. And as always, Lord, it is not the length of our devotional that is the utmost importance, but the things that we choose to allow you to transform our lives. Today's question is very profound, even though it's only one simple question. What kind of mark are we going to leave? What fingerprint, what handprint are we going to leave as a legacy for the generation that come after us? Help us not to hide behind excuses. Oh, I'm too young to even think about this or this or that, or I'm too busy. Because even if we make excuses, we're going to leave some sort of mark. So Lord, may we leave good spiritual marks for the generations to come. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Be blessed.